Hi, I'm Toby. Some of you know me. Thank you. So this Friday at 7, we have another open mic at Nola Wesley. So it's at 7102 Ferret by the Palms. So 7 o'clock on Friday at Nola Wesley, we have another open mic this month. So do whatever you want, music, comedy, poems, whatever. People do different stuff.
What's up, everybody? Hey, who said that? Someone said that. You said that. See, someone knows me. That's cool. He knows me. All right. For those of you guys that do not know me yet, personally, hopefully I'll get to meet you some point. My name is David D'Angelo. Like some people said, I'm a producer, pianist. I play other instruments too, but some people do it better than me. But if you want to get at me about production, piano playing, that's what I do. Also, heads up, last week I just found out that a blog in New Zealand reviewed my EP, which is pretty cool because I released it while I was there and I gave them some copies, and then I just checked like a week ago, they were like, hey, we have a review out. So if you want to see that, it's on my Facebook. It's cool timing because like I actually filmed a video while I was in New Zealand, and now that's going to be releasing in about a week to 2 weeks. It's premiering, and I'm not going to say where yet, but just know it's coming out and it's soon, and I'll let you know. So hopefully you guys check it out when it does come out, and I'm sure you'll enjoy it. Also, we got some homies here. Yeah.
Yo, hold on, David. Hold on. If y'all take a little glance, a little gander at this man's chest right here, we have this beautiful Born in Paradise t-shirt right here. Some selfless promotion. This man has shirts. This is his EP. Yep. They're fresh. I have one.
He has one.
It's very comfortable.
Yeah, it is. Comfortable.
When you wash it, the quality does not decline.
No.
It stays fresh, stays soft. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, there it is. Yo, I don't have an announcement, but I know who does have an announcement. These beautiful two ladies right here. Yeah, Caitlin Harris. Y'all know this girl right here?
Hi, guys. I'm Caitlin Harris. I'm a singer here at Loyola. And I actually was just working on a project with Dylan Kidd. I'm here to tell you that he's releasing it tomorrow. It's a single. It's called Tell Me. And he's releasing it on his SoundCloud. His last name is spelled K-I-D-D. So go check it out. It's his first single that he's releasing off of his upcoming album. Or EP, whatever. So, yeah, go check it out.
What's good? My name is Jordan Cox, and me and Sam Wise over here are dropping a track on Monday called State of the Union. So, y'all look out for that, for sure.
I still have Dola Wants. Just saying. If y'all want some Dola Wants, hit me up. Huh? What's up? Throw some. I already did that. None of you copped any, so I'm not about to throw any more. You know what I'm saying?
Happy Mardi Gras. Who's in mood to learn? I know I am. I have a bunch of announcements, so listen up. The first of which, if you are an individual who wants to attend the MEDEM conference with me personally and all the other cool people who are going to France, you need to email me. We are booking those conference registrations, train tickets, etc. on March 27th. That means that if you miss March 27th, you're out of the game. I've already talked to all the people at Study Abroad, and we have to sign forms and all kinds of legal stuff to keep you all alive and out of jail. And hopefully having a good time. So March 27th is the cutoff. I have some of your emails of previously interested folks. If you are interested, you have to email me. And if you want to attend, you have to go through me, okay? Second thing, this and next week are the Feminist Festival here at Loyola. Can I get a whoop whoop for ladies? Woo! All right, so being a feminist doesn't mean that you are a lady, doesn't mean that you think that ladies are better than men. Being a feminist means that you think people are equal of any sort, color, creed, origin, whatever. We are all equal. So here's a couple of cool things to celebrate equality. On Wednesday, it's International Women's Day. So come by the One Loyola Room, that's that little corner in the Dana Center, and see all the cool information and talk to some really cool equality-driven folk about what's going on this week. The big news, if you have not seen it, our Tiny Desk Concert award-winning artist, Tank and the Bangas, is here on campus on Friday. So in the Peace Quad, starting at about 3, we're going to have some student opening acts and some Loyola bands opening for Tank and the Bangas, okay? So be there, be square. Last thing, if you're like, yeah, Tank's kind of cool, but man, that Kate Duncan is so much cooler. How can I get more of her in my life? Next Wednesday, thank you. Next Wednesday. What is next Wednesday? March 15th. March 15th, thank you. Next Wednesday, we are doing a Women in the Arts, Women in the Industry panel. This time, 5 o'clock, but on a Wednesday, so I know y'all are free. It's an hour-long panel. I've got Trina Shoemaker, who is a Grammy Award-winning sound engineer. She's worked with all kinds of badass folk. I've also got Lisa LaFleur, who is an alum of this program and started her own company up in New York and is now back here working for the LPO in the nonprofit world. And the last person I have is Missy Cohen. Missy Cohen is a sound and music supervisor and editor who has worked on The Big Lebowski, Sex and the City, Vinyl, all kinds of rad stuff. So come hang out. It's an hour. Again, we're talking about equality, talking about what it takes to get to where you want to be in the industry. All right? So that's 5 o'clock next Wednesday, the 15th. Thank y'all. In the St. Charles room. Thank you.
Not in here.
Oh.
It's in the St. Charles room, not in this room. So we'll all be there on Wednesday in the St. Charles room. Or B square, thank you. Okay, just one more quick thing. Wednesday, May 3rd, is the last day of class this semester. And it's also a very special day because all our ensembles are performing at the House of Blues. Main room, just like last December. Very important. Last semester, Sandy Hinderly decided that we needed someone to market the event, and he appointed Sarah Wall without her even having any say in the matter. And Sarah did a great job, but she had no say in the matter. So I'm looking for one or two or three people to help out with the marketing of the House of Blues show. If you'd be willing to do this, we'd be very, very grateful. Not only me and the rest of the faculty, but your fellow students who are performing in the ensembles as well. If you're able to help out with helping us put on a great show at the House of Blues, please email me, lfaber@loyno.edu. And now we're ready to rock, right? Okay. Well, this is a very exciting event today, but we have 3 Loyola alumni, and we have our very own Tim Kappel to interview them. And to introduce them, you're going to introduce them, Ethan? All right. The forum committee's own, Ethan Gurman.
Okay, so we have Maeve Brophy from Ultra Records, and then backstage, if you guys want to come out, if you can hear me, I don't know. Are they? I don't know. Okay, what's up? Oh, there we go. All right, we got Andrew Goodwin and Mike Harvey. All right.
That's a lot of lights.
All right.
Microphone check.
So this is good. We haven't met. I met May for 5 minutes, so this will be an education for me as well. So I thought this is the young alumni panel, and I think that everybody in here can appreciate the need to find employment in one way, one form or another after they get out of college. So given that you all have attained that level of employment in the industry that you intended to be in, presumably, I think it'd be helpful for them to know how you did it. So what were the steps that you took while you were in college? What were the things that you did immediately upon leaving college? And how have you continued to further your career? So that's kind of the scope of what I'm hoping to cover. So let's start at the beginning. What did you do? Well, where are you now? And how did your experience in this program, how has that helped you in doing what you do now?
Or not.
But yes, it did. Right. Yeah, go ahead.
All right. Well, I record and produce music and play in a few bands. It's a fiddle player. And definitely started with both those things as a student here at Loyola.
And what year did you get out?
2001.
Yeah. So what did you do immediately when you got out? Did you start doing, do you do session work? Or are you doing?
I have always had, at the time I took a job teaching some after school guitar lessons and violin lessons while getting a studio together and taking studio clients as well. And started with some gigging at that point too. And so now I don't do as much teaching at this point, but so my schedule's pretty busy with the recording studio.
And so when you were in school here, that you had always, did you always intend to get out and open up your own studio and to do to serve as a producer engineer, or were you looking to do other things?
I started out as a music education major.
Yeah.
So on the path to, I guess, be like a middle school orchestra director or something.
Right.
And I guess took the first MIDI production class and was just really enamored by all of that. And so took the second one, recording techniques 1 and 2, and then became teacher assistant for both of those classes, and you know, spend as much time as possible in the labs and in the studio here. And at that time, just started buying some gear of my own. And
did you ever do any internships? Or I mean, I just said you were doing some TA work. What about internships?
Yeah, I never did. I always went on my own, and there were a few times along the way that I sought out the mentorship of some of the other studio owners of some of the bigger studios. Well, at the time it was Axis Studio, was Misha's studio. Now that his new studio is Esplanade, you'll probably know that as one of the bigger studios in town. And got a lot from him, learned from David Farrell and from mastering engineer out in Florida, Bob Katz.
Very cool. So, I mean, obviously internships weren't necessarily crucial to your advancement in your career, but do you accept interns? Have you ever had interns before? What's that process? I mean, do you enjoy having those kids around?
I have one right now, and who's a student through Recording Connection. Which is a program where it's like a 20-week associates type program for recording techniques, and they pair students with studios in their hometown, wherever they are, and the coursework is mainly online, but then you have a mentor to help with that, and that's what I do, and then they spend some time as an intern in the studio.
Very cool.
Well,
very cool.
And that's a good program because I end up with an intern who is knowledgeable too.
So, I mean, apart from being knowledgeable, what would you say is sort of the most, the quality you most look for in an intern? Obviously, knowing what to do around a studio is probably the bare minimum. So if you're looking between, you know, candidate A and candidate B, or what makes a good intern for you?
Someone who just really wants to be there and really, really
positive attitude, that sort of thing.
Yeah, eats it, breathes it.
Yeah.
You know, you just have to really want to do it. You have to really like it.
Yeah.
And that's the most important thing.
Awesome. Let's move on. So tell them what you do. Where are you now? How'd you get there? And when did you graduate from here?
Or sure.
When did you graduate?
I graduated in 2011.
Okay.
I do like freelance festival production work for different festivals. So I kind of got started at Loyola by taking advantage of like all the volunteer and just jazz fest opportunities, things like that. And that was really what kind of got me into doing festival production work and just learning that world. It started off like carrying, you know, road cases and doing very sort of minimal jobs, but, you know, taking any opportunity that I could and then just kind of figuring out who those people were that worked for those companies and staying in contact with them and then just always sending out hundreds of emails to follow up about other gigs. And I started working with a company called Superfly, who back when they were doing riverboat shows during Jazz Fest, sort of like late night shows. Yep. And so I started working with those guys doing a variety of different...
This was while you were in school or when you got out?
Yeah, this is when I was still in school, yeah. Okay. And doing volunteer jobs with them, and they are the producers of Bonnaroo, as well as like Outside Lands and a number of other festivals. And so that led me to working Bonnaroo, which led me to working other festivals, and it was just sort of like, you know, keeping in contact with all these people. And that's really what I feel like is the best way to kind of get into, at least from a festival world, but I feel like this applies to really anything in the industry, is just like finding out those people and staying in contact with them.
Yeah.
And just constantly just making yourself available. So that's kind of where I got started.
And so what did the first 6 months out of college look like for you?
Actually, when I graduated, I started working for a record label called Putumayo, which did like world music compilations. But that was sort of like my full-time thing, and I would just do sort of freelance stuff for festivals seasonally, usually like spring and summer. So I'd actually have to like take my vacation days and use it towards going to these festivals because I like really wanted to work festivals. And I didn't really have an opportunity to intern. I never interned for a festival, but I was always working like whenever they had an event and was always reaching out to people. So that became more of a regular thing. I got more opportunities. So I ended up leaving the record label and just going full time into just contract work for festivals all over.
So you said that this staying in contact with people, finding out who the people are, who the players are, and then staying in contact with them. How do you, what's the dividing line, at least, and do you think you ever crossed it between being persistent and being a pest?
You know? No. I mean, I've a million times crossed that line.
Yeah.
But like, you just kind of have to cross the line. I mean, the way I look at it is that if I'm somebody who has years of work experience and some eager kid reaches out to me and is being annoying, like, I wouldn't see that as being pestering. I would be like, this kid's eager, so I got to give him a chance. So if you think about it too much and you just kind of, you know, if you're worried about being pestering, I wouldn't, because most people are human, and if they see that and your drive and you're into it, you know, when they do have a position that comes up, you know, you're going to be the first person that goes into their mind.
Right.
So there is probably a line, but don't worry about crime.
Don't show up at their house, maybe.
Maybe don't show up at their house.
Don't show up at their house. But apart from that,
that's probably where the line is, yeah.
So, but I mean, that's always been, I think it was a concern for me. But I think you're right. I mean, it's you can't overthink these sorts of things. You know,
worst case scenario, they say no, and you're in the same situation. Now you don't have the gig that you never had anyway.
Right.
So
right.
It doesn't really.
So how long were you sort of just hustling as a side gig before you left Putumayo?
I mean, I was doing it off and on all through college, and then I guess Putumayo was kind of like when I would have opportunities like through the summer, and then I was there for about 3 years at Putumayo, so like I got that right when I graduated. I was lucky to like just have a job right then, because we had opened an office down here. And so 3 years or so, and that's when I started picking up things. I got regular work with like the Superfly guys that When it's an interesting world in festivals too, is because a lot of people do contract. So somebody who's doing, you know, managing a lot of the operations for one festival may also be doing it at Coachella and all these other festivals. So if you, you know, it's not really always just this internal team. So if you, you know, if you work well with that person and you have a good relationship, you know, you could get three other gigs from that if you stay in contact with them. So I was there for about 2 years, and then I, 2 or 3 years of Putumayo, and then I went full time.
So I think that's one of the bits of advice that I give, you know, students is just get a job. My view on it is just get a job in the music industry. Right. It doesn't have to be where you ultimately want to land, you know, what you want to do for the rest of your career, but staying in the industry, and it sounds like that's something you were able to do. You weren't thrilled about going to, you didn't want to work for a record label, but you...
Yeah, I mean, I thought I wanted to work for a record label. I thought about getting into, like, publishing and licensing. I thought about getting into entertainment law. Like, I was all over the place.
Right.
But, and I think that's going to happen to everybody.
Sure.
Like, especially going through this program, all the classes you take are, you know, you're like, I want to do that. You might try that out, but, like, 5 years down the road, you might go a completely different route.
Yeah.
But I think you're right. Like, just staying in the business and just trying to build a network is really the most important thing, and then you'll figure it out.
Yeah, I think that's right. I think that the network that you have in the music industry is going to serve you wherever you go.
Right.
Right? So, and it's not the least of times it will serve you is when you're looking to make that change.
Right.
Because we're all finding out about these job opportunities long before anyone else.
Yeah, it's unbelievable how many contacts that I worked at when I started, even at Putumayo, ironically, that I'm now reaching out to, that are doing some sort of event thing. So it's so weird how you don't know these relationships, how later down the road they're gonna, you know, affect you and
right.
what you're doing and
right.
stuff.
So. No, and there is no way to know that in advance, right?
Right?
And so that would probably, another thing that I always tell students is be kind and decent to people,
yeah.
you know, that you are coming into contact with, particularly that are in your industry. Because it really, you know, life is kind of funny that way, and you see these people come back around. And I know, you know, that reputation carries, you know, it can follow you around, and that's for better and worse.
Right.
Right. You know, you got a good reputation,
it's
more people gonna hire
so
you.
So cliche, but it really is one of those industries. It's about who you know. So
yeah.
You got to keep those relationships, and it is kind of all sort of referrals based,
right.
and that's how it. Seems to operate.
That's. I think that can be frustrating for a lot of people to know that, you know, it's not a meritocracy.
Yeah.
This in this, you know, that it was frustrating for me at least that it's not. You know, what it means is that no matter how good you get, there could be somebody else who's just more well connected than you.
Totally,
that's getting
it's
the job.
It's gonna happen all the time.
It's gonna happen
yeah.
frequently.
Yeah.
And so knowing that, you might say, well, should I spend more time in college hitting the books or? You know, making connections
out there, yeah.
and there's got to be a balance, obviously, but knowing that it's not a meritocracy in the music industry by any means should sort of inform, I think, what you're doing in college. Not to tell you to do poorly, but definitely don't miss opportunities to get out there and network. So thank you.
Sure.
Maybe what do you do? You're a more recent alumni.
Yes.
So we had 2011, 2001, and then you are 2015.
Yeah.
All right. So you're fresh out.
Fresh.
And you have found a really cool job working
yeah.
at Ultra Records, and you're in Los Angeles. You said.
I'm in LA.
Okay.
In Hollywood.
So tell us how did you manage to find your way over there?
Well, I interned a bunch when I was here. That's
so what
like
are some of the internships
thing.
That you did?
So I worked with this guy, Joel C. High, who's a music supervisor. I think I was like having a meeting with John and he was like, what do you want to do? I was like, I don't know. Music supervision is cool. And so I called Joel and interviewed and got an internship with him. So that's why I started. He does all the music for Tyler Perry movies. So that was cool. I got to work on like Madea's Witness Protection. It was so good.
Classic.
And what's the other one? Temptations of a Marriage Counselor, something like that. So it was really cool. It was like very first hand. Joel is always down in New Orleans. So
yeah
he is a good guy for people to meet, I would say. So I worked with him. And then that was my freshman year going to sophomore year.
So you're interning freshman year. You're already interning.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
I was like, why not? Like, just do
and
it.
If you don't, how are you? What kind of student were you? Grade-wise.
What do you mean, grade-wise?
Yeah, what kind of grades did you get?
I got by.
You got by?
Yeah.
Yeah. So you found a way to manage that, to balance that.
Well, I would do it for summers, because I'm from LA, which, I mean, it helped.
Yep.
I mean, a lot of internships, like, I interned at another company, and they actually helped people who weren't from LA to, like, find housing and stuff, so they were good about that. But, yeah, I went home over the summer and interned with him, and then would like stay in contact with him, you know, because he was just a good guy. And like, talk about relationships, like if you ask anybody in the music industry, they know Joel, and they're like, yeah, he's such a good guy, and like, you don't find that very often. So I did that, and then I next summer I went home and I worked for this company called Buna Murray, and they do reality TV shows. So I worked with them, and they work on like Kardashians and like Real World and The Challenge. And so I did that, and then I went to London and studied abroad, which I recommend if anyone wants to do that. And because of Joel, my relationship with Joel, he set me up with an internship there. And so I worked with this place called Cutting Edge, and they do like music scores and like music supervision stuff. And so I got to like work and intern in London. That was so rad. And then that was it, I think. And then I ended up getting a job at Buna Murray, which is the place I interned with. So, you know, I was like, hey, I'm graduating. I need to have a job. My parents were like, do your thing. Like, don't come back.
Right.
So I got a job there. And then I was there for a year and a half. And then another relationship thing, like my friend hit me up and was like, hey, Ultra's hiring. And I was like, okay. And I applied and I got it. And I've been there like 7 months now. So, but that, like, the job, like, wasn't even online or anywhere.
Right.
You know, it was just like, hey, like, you could be cool here. And so,
yeah.
Yeah. But it was literally internships, like, and just, like, going out and just, like, hustling, you know, and just, like, being nice to people and just, like, hungry to, you know, like, learn more and stuff like that.
Right.
Yeah.
So what about sort of developing your network? You know, I think a lot of people are, if they're, you know, freshmen, maybe even seniors here, they don't have that network, or it's not as expansive. But it sounds like for you, it doesn't really need to be super expansive. It just needs to be with the right people.
Yeah,
because
I mean,
you had Joel. And
I didn't really know anyone either,
yeah,
you know, but I was just like, this is what I want to do. So John gave me that contact, and it was kind of just like, the rest is history, you know?
Right.
Kind of just like, all right, call him. I actually had like the wrong email for him, and he didn't hit me up because it was the wrong email. And I was like, why is he not responding? And then I looked back like a couple weeks later, and I was like, oh, it was the wrong email. So I like reached out again, and then I got on the phone with him, and like that was it. So it was like, but being persistent, you know, like,
right,
I want this.
Not just saying, I guess they don't
well,
want to speak
didn't respond
to me.
Yeah, exactly. Right. So, yeah.
What about you? What about, did you do any network? I mean, was your networking natural, or did you like try and seek out, you know, music industry groups or professional professionals to try and build that network?
Yeah, I mean, I guess it was a mix of like trying, again, just I was taking any live event opportunity that I could, but from French Quarter Festival to Black Pot Festival in Lafayette, and any sort of event which would just help me. And then I would always keep in mind, like, all right, who's the person that I would want to find out, even if I just say hello, but figure out their name or something.
Right.
And then, you know, sometimes just get a little crazy online with like LinkedIn or just Googling who people are. And sometimes I would email them just out of the blue and just see if there was some sort of, you know, connection there through, at the time, Loyola or anybody that I worked with that maybe could refer me to them. But yeah, I mean, when I was first doing it, I mean, I think I had like an Excel sheet of contacts.
Yeah.
I just, you know, was always, because it's important. I mean, there's so many people doing different things. And even today, like, I still go back to that sometimes just to, oh yeah, that event or that guy. And like, maybe I should reach out to them about this. So, I mean, start an Excel document.
Yeah, I think one of my mentors when I was interning in college,
one of my mentors, and there's probably a million different ways to do this, whether it's, you know, customer relationship managers or whatever, but if you looked in his Outlook database, you know, every contact he sort of had in the details field, he had things about that person that, you know, they had experienced together, or, you know, an event that they saw each other at. I mean, it takes a lot of work to right. sort of keep that database, you know, fresh. But when you're looking for work and you're trying to get out there and network, or you're trying to expand your network, I think those are the sorts of things that set it apart is, you know, if you can not only remember somebody's name, but also refresh them as to where was it that I saw you last, right? It makes them feel more comfortable. Right.
And it's that 6 degrees of separation. Right. Like somebody is going to know somebody eventually, you know. So the more that you build upon that network and have it, the easier it becomes to connect with certain people, because, you know, they end up knowing somebody, and it's, you know, and just kind of reaching out to people. Like going back to what I said, like just hit people up out of the blue sometimes, and just say, you know, I'm eager. You don't have much experience, which is a lot of times the case early on. Just be like, you know, I don't know if you're looking for some sort of low entry position or an internship, but, you know, I really want to help out doing this thing. And I feel like a well-written email to somebody expressing interest can go a long way.
Sure.
You know, just that alone. So just, yeah, not being afraid to just hit people up.
So when you got out, I mean, you had to generate your own studio business. I mean, yes. So what were some of the things? I know we have a lot of, you know, producer engineers in the program. There's, you know, not enough studios for all of them to go into. So presumably, some of them are going to be opening up their own shop and their own production companies. So what were some of the things that you did right when you got out to sort of generate business?
I went to a lot of shows.
Yeah.
I saw a lot of bands, a lot of artists, and, you know, local artists, high school kids, college students, and I talked to them and I tried to get business. And
what I've always, you know, if for you, was it more important that they could pay, or just more important that they got in the door?
The first couple projects were on spec,
yeah,
where we put up the money for ran it for like to press 100 copies of their at the time. It was a cassette tape time, and we're able to just get back a little something, you know, to make it worth our while from them selling that at the shows. And and then it was, you know, not a lot of money on the projects, but as you get a little bit of money for it, you get some experience and you get more gear with that, and then you get more experience and better gear, and you can ask for more money, so then you can
right
just kind of build it up that way.
Yeah.
But yeah, the network came, and then like now I don't have to really, I love to go to shows, but, you know, I spend a lot of time playing shows or at home. I have a 4-year-old now, but you know, a lot of my work now comes as referrals from other clients. So you get that thing going as well.
I think that's one of the marks of a sustainable enterprise, is when the referral work starts to, you know, where you're not having to generate the work constantly, right? Where the work is coming to you, whether it's as an entertainment lawyer, as a producer engineer, you know, doing festival production. I think that to me, particularly for a young entrepreneur who has their own business, that to me would be one early level, like early stage success.
Right.
Is that if your reputation is generating you business when you're not there, right? So you don't have to be in the place doing the thing, but your reputation is, and right, doing that work for you. So I think that's, and it, hopefully it comes around the time that your life is diversifying in a way. You know, you're having kids, you're doing, yeah, these other things. So maybe they don't necessarily want you to be out in the clubs, you know, until, or you don't want to be out in the clubs until 1 o'clock every night.
Yeah, well.
Maybe you do.
I do enjoy it, but yeah. I mean, I also enjoy other things
right.
that are going on too. So, you know, it's a good life.
Yeah.
And yeah, just get back with what you guys were saying. The database stuff. Yeah. If somebody hands me a business card, I put all the info into the contacts in my phone.
Right.
Just in case that person calls up out of the blue, their name, their info is all just pops up right there and I know who they are, and little bits of personal information, or you know, whatever. They're a bass player. They're in this band. They're, you know, I met them playing at this club, and you know that kind of info.
Yeah,
it is important to keep that kind.
No,
of
the details matter. You know, the details matter, and it's there's a lot of people that are out there looking for work, and so the more that you can, you know, separate yourself and distinguish yourself. I think that's really the key. So when you figured out that you wanted to be a music supervisor when you were a freshman?
I mean, no, I would watch those iTunes commercials. You guys remember those with the dancing silhouettes? I was like, how, that's so cool. Like, how did they find that music to get put on those commercials? And so that was, I don't know, maybe like middle school. I don't know. That was weird. I was like, I want to do that. So then when I got to college, I was like, for sure, like that's.
So that when you came to the program, you knew when you started out.
It was, yeah, it was like my interest. And now, of course, I'm not doing that. I started off like on that path, but then I was like, oh, no, I want to do more music. But yeah, that was kind of my thing. I was like, I really want to do that.
And so now you are in the creative. I mean, you're still doing creative.
So I'm on like the other side of music supervision. I like my clients are music supervisors. Mm-hmm. So it's like, hey, I want a song that sounds like Steve Aoki, but I don't have Steve Aoki money. Do you know? Is there anything else in your catalog that kind of sounds like that? So then I'll put together like a playlist. I'm like, use this.
Yeah.
I can give this to you for this amount of money and these rights. It's like a whole thing. It's like a new world, but it's cool. So as opposed to being like on the other side of the creative, like working with, you know, the creative team, like the people who are making the scenes, you know, like the editors, the producers, instead of like in that world. Yeah. I'm just like on the other side.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think I know I showed up at my music industry degree program with nothing but like sort of a vague idea of what I wanted to do in the music industry. And it somehow involved, you know, rock stardom and these sorts of things. But how did you, you know, what do you think you would tell students as they're trying to narrow that funnel, right? Where you have all of these classes that you're taking that are in management, they're in legal, they're in festival
production.
Don't
be limited. Like literally I'm figuring out all types of new career paths now that I'm in the industry. I didn't know that this job that I had right now was a thing when I started, you know? So I think it's just like, just learn. Like if you really want to do music, then it's like, just be smart about, you know, like, I don't know, just be curious.
Yeah.
Really, truly. Like don't limit yourself and be like, oh, this is what I want to do. And then just like have this, you know, vision of that. That's it. Cause like, you're going to find so many things that you can do in the industry and that are cool. And you can like find your niche, whatever, you know, it's cool.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's what I would say.
What about you? I mean, is it more important for you to, you know, for sophomore or junior or even a freshman to sort of have a focus would you say if you're in college, just go ahead and explore it all and you'll figure it out when you get out of college, you'll find something.
Yeah. I mean, I would say do it all just to figure it out. I mean, I thought for the longest time I wanted to get into like, you know, music supervisor and like doing publishing and copyright stuff, which then kind of led me into like wanting to do entertainment law. So I did all those things at Loyola. And then I took my LSATs and was like, I don't want to do entertainment law. And then, you know, but if I didn't do those things, and there's so many opportunities at Loyola to like just try those different things and see if you like them. But to like narrow it, I mean, that's really the only way to narrow it, I think, is to just, because your situation's going to change. You might be moving to new cities or you might get married or like it depends on kind of what's happening in your life. And I feel like unless you, know or have tried multiple different things, you know, you're never really going to know.
So it sounds like all of you were at least able to find a job in the music industry upon graduation, right? I mean, nobody had to go work outside of the industry that you wanted to be in. I would say that's not the case for everybody, right? Even me as a lawyer, I mean, I had to do things outside of take cases that weren't at all related to what I wanted to do initially, just in order to make ends meet. And I'm positive that there will be some people in here that have to do the same thing. So I think, you know, what advice would you have for somebody if graduation comes around, you don't have a job, there's no point in sort of reflecting on, well, I should have done more while while I was here. What's your advice for them when they, you know, the day after graduation, they want to be in the music industry, but they just don't have a job?
I would say that they should just not worry about that because, I mean, it seems like such a far distance thing. Like, you know, I'm not working in this industry. It's easy to kind of get beat out on that. But in a few years, like, things could be very different and opportunities could come. So definitely take a job. I mean, you have to take a job.
You have to live.
But always be looking for, you know, the other thing that you want to do. And just don't get too worried if it doesn't happen in a year or whatever, as long as you're kind of actively looking for those things. I mean, a lot of getting jobs goes down to who you know and timing. You know, a lot of times it's about just being at the right place at the right time. So, you know, I probably wouldn't have stayed at the record label as long as I had other opportunities been available earlier. You know,
right.
I just did that. I mean, it was in music still, granted, but, you know, I was still able to kind of like do that and still sort of like drive my passion. And one of the things about figuring out what you want to do is I realized that I didn't like sitting at a desk all day. And so the nice thing about festival production work is that I have to do a lot of desk work, but then I can get out and be on the ground and do those things. And so those are the little things that you figure out even about your personality.
Right.
Like, you know what, this is kind of where I just fit better and what I want to do. So it's not necessarily sometimes always the field. It's just, you know, components of yourself where you're like, yeah, I don't want to be behind a desk. I do better by going out there and being on the ground and interacting.
But you had to sit behind a desk to know that you didn't want to be there.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, that's, I mean, experiential learning, you know what I mean? Just having, there's no way to know something like that about yourself until you actually get there and recognize, wait, this is not what I want.
And I would add to that, though, is like even try to have an open mind of the fact that you can transfer skills. Like I did sales stuff. So I was selling CDs to people. And then I went into festival, you know, production work. But, you know, those type of sales skills, now when I'm talking to festivals and trying to pitch certain programs to them and doing things like those skills transferred over to that. So there's a lot of skills that are just universal in certain job types that will, you know, don't just think, well, because I'm working in this different industry that nothing from that industry could transfer over to, you know, that's sort of where you learn your habits and work ethics and certain things that, you know, will apply to pretty much any industry.
No, I think that's a great point.
That's a really good point. I used to work in Smashburger and like sold burgers, and now I sell music. You know what I mean? Like it's just interchangeable.
Yeah.
Truly. Like, don't worry if you don't have a job right after college.
But like, no, your quality, your sort of, I think that's really interesting about, you know, you're sort of establishing your identity as a professional in the field, right? Yeah. And your habits, if you're the way that you approach tending bar or selling burgers, you know, it's not going to be all that different.
Right.
From the way that you go and sell music, right? Because you're either going to show up, do your job, be a pleasure to be around, and make sure that people around you respect the work that you're doing, or you're not, right? It doesn't really matter what you're doing. So I think that's knowing that you can transfer these sorts of skills over once you do, I think that's really important.
I guess it's also important to know that you need to always actively be working on whatever you really want to do, because you know nobody's going to make you get up in the morning and do that if you're doing another career path to make money. So you know you just have to keep that in mind and ask yourself at the end of the day, what did I do toward that? And you know, have something to say.
Yeah, there's definitely a certain discipline to it. I think one of the things that I would recommend is keep your overhead low, right? I mean, to the greatest extent you can. If you can keep your personal overhead low, the amount of time you have to spend working that other job is reduced, right? So, you might have to continue living like a college student for a couple of years while you figure it out. But it's probably better than going to get some condo somewhere and having to work to live, right? Mm-hmm. So managing to do that. But professional organizations, there's young professional organizations. I know when I was getting out of school and in law school in Nashville, there was a group called Solid. Do you all know of any young professionals organizations? I'm sure there are music industry young professional organizations.
Yeah, I mean, there's like a woman in music organization that's pretty cool. I just went to a thing for, they have like a Guild of Music Supervisor thing that you can be a part of. I don't know, the young, I don't really know. But.
Yeah, well, I mean, I think that there, I'm positive that you, that there are opportunities out there.
Well, there's a Grammy organization, Grammy, right? That's cool. AES. That's a really cool thing to join because I know there's a lot of people.
Grammy U, AES, Young Entertainment Professionals, if you end up in Nashville. I mean, there's quite a few out there. So even if you're, you know, whatever, slinging burgers, you should, that's still no excuse not to be involved with these groups, I'd say, you know, because those relationships that you build in there are presumably what's going to get you away from flipping burgers and onto what you want to do, selling music, right? Questions? Somebody's got a question. There you are.
Music industry. Yeah, Bachelor of Science.
Likewise, yeah, I did the same thing.
When I came here, there was not a music industry degree. So started out as music education, but 3 years into that, switched to music with a minor in business was what I graduated with. But at the time, my last 2 years was the start of the music business program here at Loyola, and so took all the classes that I could in that field.
Yeah.
So the man on the left, sorry, I can't remember your name. What was the process of starting a studio like? Was it just, did you start with just like a deck and a couple mics, or like did you have stuff to start with?
First record I made were an old console that we, you know, pawn shop deal, and an 8-track digital recorder, and you know, other pawn shop equipment and stuff like that. 8-at tape machines, but when Apple came out with the G4 computer, I went to DAW-based production and never looked back. That's it. But I guess for anybody doing a home setup or young producers out there, I guess if you can get one or two channels of the best stuff you can afford, that's probably going to get you a lot more mileage than trying to do a 24-channel setup of really cheap stuff. That. Something I know now, but
that's quality.
Wish I had known that.
Little favor.
I've always been struck by the way people who are in college or even grad school talk about the quote unquote real world. And having been in the music industry and in academia, I don't think one is necessarily more real than the other.
I totally agree with that.
They're both kind of unreal, but What aspect of the real world did you, was like what you thought it would be, or wasn't like what you thought it would be when you were a college student?
Bills are real. For me, I mean, I just got, I'm like, what is the deal? But I mean, it's cool. You can like, I don't know. Yeah, that was a shock. And personally, in like personal life, I guess. But the cool thing about real life is that you can just do what you want to do now. You know, at least for me, it's just like, okay, now go figure, like, go figure it out, and having that freedom, more or less, to figure it out is what I love. You know, it's hard. It's hard leaving college, but you'll be fine. Like, for real. Loyola set, I think Loyola sets you up. Loyola was good. So that's my experience.
Yeah, I mean, I would say for festivals, I thought it would be a little like this glamorous kind of like lifestyle, and you go to all these different festivals, but you realize a lot of people get jaded from doing certain things, and you have to really like be passionate about kind of what you're doing and realize that it's to make something cool happen, and it, you know, how it looks from the outside takes a lot of time and effort and sweat and tears that, like, you know, behind the scenes. So, you know, it's gonna suck a lot, but you just have to be passionate about kind of what you're doing, and then also not taking things too seriously. You know, people get fired from jobs and things change, and I think it's easy to just be like, what am I gonna do now? I'm kind of screwed. But, you know, I know people who have been working in events for 10, 20 years, and things have changed so much, and it's just like, just don't take one position or one thing too seriously, you know? Like, just try to think, like, as long as you're kind of going towards that thing, you'll be okay.
Right.
You know, that's really it.
Handling the business parts of things is definitely something that I don't like. Paperwork, you know, taxes, you know, doing the accounting of things. Somebody's got to do it. And, you know, when you're in business for yourself, that person's you. So that's probably the biggest part of the real world I don't like. But then I guess, like you were saying, there's some glamour things that you think the music industry is that it's not. And, you know, like, for instance, I do a little bit of road work with some of the bands I'm in, and, you know, being on the road is being on the road. You're literally on the road all the time. And, you know, that's most of your life, and then you spend a little bit of that life in backstages, and the best part of it is being on stage. So, you know, there's things like that, and making records is a lot of hard work. It's a lot of doing it over and over and over again till it's right. And, you know, so.
And I'll say, and I know we're 6 o'clock. So I think for me, what I would caution you all is that the longer you work in the music industry, I think the more you have to actively engage with your passion for music itself. Because the if you start, and I've been guilty of this in a number of times, where you start to conflate your career and your professional life with your love for music, and why presumably we all came to this program to start with is because we all love music. And the number of people that are jaded out there is, I mean, they're innumerable. And you run into it a lot, and if you let that sort of negative mentality infect you, it can really, you can wake up and find yourself not even liking music anymore.
It's true.
So I would actively encourage you to nurture why you're here. Remember why you went to school and why you play music and do all those things, because separate the business from the music to the...
We always go out and see music. You know, that's whenever I'm feeling jaded, it's like you have to go back out, see shows, and be like, all right, that's kind of why I'm in this, you know, get that refreshment.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much for coming, y'all.